Good morning and good afternoon. I'm Chi Chiu Ling. Today, I'm delighted to share our work, which was recently published on Science. The story here is Nesting Enhancer Network Link Multiple Non-Coding Variants to Disease Risk. Today, many technologies, including computational and experimental methods, have been developed to study enhancer biology. These methods study the enhancer biology in different aspects, including sequence conservation, biochemical annotation, gene regulation in 3D space by HiSeq, QTL for functional mapping in population, single cell purifying by imaging or sequencing, function in vitro or in vivo, functional mapping by CRISPR screening, and as well as computational prediction of enhancer regions. Based on this method, we learn the cell type specificity of enhancer biology. We also understand how enhancer regulates the gene in 3D space. Based on this method, we also have an observation that pathogenic genes are more likely to be regulated by multiple enhancers in large length scale. Indeed, in K562 cells, we observe that several disease-related genes, oncogenes, are regulated by multiple enhancers spanning long distance. For example, CRES is regulated by 5 enhancers across 400 kilobase KID 5 enhancer, 1 megabase BCL9 5 enhancer, 3 megabase, finally MINK. It's regulated by 7 enhancers across 2 megabase. We also do global analysis across several cell types. We found that more than 20% of oncogenes are regulated by multiple enhancers spanning an ultra long distance. But, however, we still don't know why multiple enhancers exist for these genes and how do they interact with each other to control gene expression. To understand it, we use MIG in K562 cells as a model to study enhancer interaction network. In K562 cells, MIG is regulated by 7 enhancers across long distance. In addition, the relationship between MIG expression and cell growth is linear. So it means that we can use cell growth as a phenotype layout to measure the effect when we inhibiting enhancer. Then the tool we use is CRISPR-I, CRISPR interference. When we design guide to target a certain enhancer, this tool could act like a switch to turn down the activity of enhancer. To study the enhancer interaction in a high resolution and in systematical way, we designed this guide to target all the enhancer region in MIG locus. Specifically, we designed 221 guides targeting these 7 enhancers. Plus 74 guides, totally we have around 300 guides in this library. Then we pair this single guide to build the multi-class library. In this library, we totally have 87,000 combination of guide pairs. Then we transduce this library into cells and culture them for 30 doubling. Then sequence the guide abundance before and after cell culture. By comparing the guide abundance before and after cell culture, we can measure the effect of inhibiting one or two enhancer. Specifically, in this library, in this multi-class library, there were some plasmids containing one guide targeting one enhancer and one control guide. They inhibit one enhancer and then repress MIG expression, then further affect cell growth. The guide depletion can be used to measure the effect of inhibiting one enhancer. Here is the example for another enhancer. At the same time, there were some plasmids containing two guides targeting two enhancers. The guide depletion can be used to measure the effect of inhibiting two enhancers. Then we can calculate whether the total effect of inhibiting two enhancers is equal to or larger than the sum of the effect of inhibiting two individual enhancers. By this comparison, we can conclude how these two enhancers interact with each other to control gene. To quantify the functional interaction, we define epistasis score. This diagram shows how we came up with the score. The y-axis here shows the guide depletion, which each user measures the effect of inhibition. If the double inhibition is equal to the sum of individual inhibition, that it means that these two enhancers regulate the gene in an additive way. Accordingly, that score is zero. If the double inhibition effect is larger than or less than the sum of the individual inhibition, then they regulate the gene in a synergistic way or in an antagonistic way. Accordingly, the epistasis score is greater than zero or less than zero. The big heat map here shows the epistasis map of guide targeting the enhancer. The redder it is, the more synergistic. We can observe several synergistic clusters inside the enhancer region of guide pairs targeting the same enhancer pairs. To simplify the result, we use the guide interaction score to calculate the enhancer interaction score by averaging the top 25 pairs. This is the map, enhancer interaction map. Based on this map, we summarize the enhancer network as a nested two-layer epistasis enhancer network. In the first layer, two enhancers interact with each other independently in an additive way. In the second layer, enhancers are far away from each other, more than 5.5 megabase in this locus. They have synergistic interaction upon perturbation in gene regulation. We call it SRE, synergistic regulatory elements. For SRE enhancer pairs, it is not enough if we only just perturb one of them, because the other enhancer in the SRE can buffer the effect. In addition, the long intern distance between SRE pairs reduces the chance of co-mutation. Then we can maintain the robustness of gene expression. Above is all the findings in this locus. Next, we would like to explore whether the nested two-layer enhancer network can be expanded to other gene loci across cells. To answer this question, we develop a machine learning model. In it, we integrate CRISPR functional genomic data with multi-omics data to run the determinants of cloning features to predict SRE. Then we predict SRE in more genes and cell types. In the model, we quantify the importance of cloning features in predicting SRE. In this result, we found that spatial DNA contact measured by HiChIP and BRD4 occupancy are the two major determinants of synergistic interaction. To explore the functional role in the SRE, we perform check looping and DNA fish to quantify their function. For spatial DNA contact, we collaborated with Professor Zhao in NIH to perform check looping to measure the changes of contact upon enhancer perturbation. In individual inhibition, E3 or E7 inhibition, we only observe specific contact between E3 and E7 with other enhancers decrease. However, in both inhibition, E3 and E7, we can observe that all the contact in these locus are decreased. For BRD4 occupancy, we mark MYC in green by DNA fish and BRD4 in red by immunostaining. In the wild type, we can observe that they co-localize that. Then in individual inhibition, E3 and E7, we can observe that the co-localization between MYC and BRD4 decrease. And in both inhibition, we cannot observe any BRD4 occupancy. The occupancy of BRD4 in Miklos collapsed. By this result, we validate that spatial DNA context and BRD4 occupancy are two main factors in synergistic interaction for SRE. After validation, we apply the model to predict SRE pairs in other gene loci. Here is an example, BCL9 in KFAX2 cells. BCL9 is also another oncogene. It is regulated by five enhancers across long distance. E1E3 is the top one predicted SRE in this enhancer network. Next, we quantify the effect of inhibiting E1 or E3. To measure the effect, we quantify BCL9 expression to measure the effect. In individual inhibition, we can observe that the effect is really small. Then we calculate the expected additive effect. However, in both inhibition, E1 inhibiting E1 and E3 at the same time, we can observe that the effect, the actual effect is much larger, is significantly larger than the additive effect. So we saw that SRE, the predicted SRE, E1 and E3 do have synergistic interaction upon perturbation in gene regulation. We also predict SRE in whole genome scale across cell types. All these results can be found in our developed website, EnhancerNet website. In the past decade, GWAS study have revealed millions of DNA variants associated with the DG. In single gene DG, most variants are coding with large effect. However, in complex DG such as cancer, most variants, more than 90% of the variants are non-coding. Furthermore, the individual effects on DG loads are small. These two main factors confound the functional understanding of DG associated variants. Understanding the regulatory role of non-coding aberrant early elements like enhancer, silencer is the key to understand the function of millions of non-coding variants. Our understanding of the enhancer network should help us to understand how multiple non-coding variants interact with each other to determine the risk of disease. Specifically, to exploit, we applied SRE prediction model to across cells. Then we can predict SRE enhancers in gene regulation, then use them to link non-coding variants. We call it SRE variants. If there were two enhancer variants happen in the enhancer at the same time, where the SRE variants affect the gene expression and then the clinical risk in a synergistic way. Here we show one example result for AL risk. CSD7 is a pathogenic gene in leukemia. And GM12A7A is the ALL associated cell type. In this cell, CST7 is regulated by 12 enhancer across long distance. Then we apply our model to predict SI enhancers within its network, enhancer network. B1B11 is the top one enhancer pairs, which are more likely to act in synergistic way upon perturbation. Then we link them to variants as are in variants. Based on the genotype of the variants, we calculate the odds ratio to measure the clinical risk. If the ratio is greater than one, it means that this genotype is more risky. We only consider individual variants, three genotypes in B11 variants, three genotypes in B1 variant. Other odds ratio are just around one. On the other hand, we can consider the genotype combinations of SRE variants. There were nine genotypes combination, in a certain combination, CC in B11, GG in B1. The odds ratio is 2.37. It is significantly higher risk for having disease. This result shows SI variants can indirectly alter clinical risk. Furthermore, we apply SI prediction model in genome-wide. Based on the SI predict score, we defined two groups, SIE group with high intelligence score, non-SIE group with low intelligence score. Then we test how many of the enhanced pairs in these two groups, in which the linked variants have epistasis effect on LL risk. The results show that SIE group is significantly higher than the non-SIE group. It means that SIE prediction model efficiently link multiple enhanced variants to jointly influence disease risk. Our work has resulted in these findings. We used CRISPR multi-class screening to find the next two-layer enhanced epistatic network, in which network we can explain how multiple enhancers cooperate to maintain the gene expression. Within this network, we define SIE, which are critical in maintaining the robustness of gene expression upon perturbation. For SIE regulation, spatial DNA contact and BRD4 occupancy are the two main factors to maintain the synergistic interaction. But in order to explore more SIE across genes, across cell types, we developed the machine model to predict SIE. And then finally, we apply this SIE prediction model to interpret the epistasis effect of multiple non-coding variants on disease risk.
Pretty good. Kids went back to school on Wednesday, so bit of a change of schedule. Yeah, finally.
Katie, I think you want to mute.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Okay, thank you. So for this work, first and foremost, I would like to thank our mentor, Dr. Chi, for his fantastic guidance and the ongoing support. It has been a teamwork. Yin Xia and Shao is other corpus author. We have discussed the project hundreds of times. We also thank our two collaborating lab and other members in Qi Lab. Finally, thank you for your interest in our work.